take so many selfies.
Because people love themselves.
It's like proof that you're living.
I exist. Mm-hmm. Perfect angle. Look at how skinny my chin looks.
Our nation right now is divided in half.
Everybody is here because they want people to know on their Instagram.
Why did you come today?
I believe this whole thing is orchestrated to bring America down. Take those things off.
This whole thing is just a big show.
Do you think this is a turning point in American history?
I think it's a turning point in the history of the world.
Where are all those Christians that talk about helping people?
Rick Hong here for Hollywood First Look Features. Today, I am talking with Alexandra Pelosi for her documentary, American Selfie. Alexandra, I wanted to tell you congratulations. I'm just gonna get right to it. Was this hard to shoot this documentary?
Well, let me say this. I never thought in my lifetime, you know, I spent a decade as a network news producer, and I've spent two decades making documentaries. This is my 13th film. I never thought in my lifetime that I would get gassed by my own government in peacetime.
Wow.
Yeah, when I was at Lafayette Square that day, before the curfew, very important to say, and I saw the National Guard shooting tear gas and shooting rubber bullets at peaceful protesters and journalists, for that matter. Like, I saw friends of mine that were journalists getting shot by rubber bullets. And then the government gaslit us and said, oh, that wasn't the National Guard, and that wasn't tear gas, and those weren't chemical agents we were using. But we had we took some home as souvenirs and showed people to say, look, they were shooting chemical agents. So I think when you ask, was it hard? I think I will never get over the fact, I made the point, I'm a very old lady, I've been around a long time, I've made a lot of these films. I never thought in my lifetime that I'd get gassed by my own government, if that helps. I mean, if that's an answer.
I was thinking while I was watching this, you go into, you know, you're covering a lot of like places where there's tension. So I was wondering if you were ever nervous or scared. So was that like the most scariest or nervous time? Or do you kind of have like a set plan? Like, this is my escape plan if something goes awry.
Now you're making me feel like a really bad mom. I did not have an escape plan. You know, I film everything myself with a handheld camera, and I don't bring anyone with me. So I don't really, I'm not like an entourage of people that's, you know, I always feel sort of like I'm always guerrilla style. I always feel like I can get in and out. I can.
True journalist. Yeah.
But I will say this, everyone likes to talk about 2020. It was this explosive year and oh my God, the revolution in the streets, which it was. But when I was in Minneapolis in 2019 at a Trump rally, when Trump was attacking the Muslim women, you know, that whole thing, it was pretty dark then. I mean, it was pretty dangerous. There was tear gas being used by the police, and there were Black Lives Matter protesters back in 2019. Everyone likes to pay attention, like, oh, this is the year that white America woke up, because they noticed, oh, Black Lives Matter. But the Black Lives Matter movement, it was out there in the streets, and they were getting tear gassed by the police last year. So I like to, you know, I've had a lot of bad run-ins over the years, and it didn't just happen this year. This wasn't the darkest chapter in American history. It's been bad. You know, it's been bad out there on the streets for a while. It's really hard not to be sad about America right now, but it's been getting worse. It's getting worse for sure, but it's been getting darker too. But I don't know if you understand what I'm trying to say, which is like, it's easy
Absolutely.
To say, wow, what a dark year, but last year was bad too.
So then when you start this, you know, especially when you're doing a documentary, you can have an idea of what you want to cover, but there is no roadmap to when you kind of finish, because everything can always take a different turn. And from when you started, did you ever think that you would kind of end at a pandemic?
Well, I couldn't have anticipated the whole virus killing people and the fact that a virus kills people, that's okay. I mean, I guess. I mean, I'm not saying it's okay, but it happens. But the idea that then it's killing disproportionately sort of the Black and brown Americans, and then the white Americans are all saying, I'm not wearing a mask, I don't care. I didn't realize that people were such assholes. I didn't realize.
Wow.
I thought there would be a little more sort of like, I thought we cared about each other a little bit more. It's like, we didn't really care when it was Black and brown people living in, I live in New York City. Right? So we were ground zero. And it was actually happening in the zip codes that were a little browner and blacker. And people didn't seem to care when it was Black and brown people. You know, there were rallies to say, let's reopen. I never realized that it was going to be profit over lives. I didn't really realize that, you know, that that was who we were as a country. I always sort of thought when she was the fan, we'd be a little bit nicer as humans. But I'm really, really disappointed in Americans, especially white Americans.
That is like amazing to hear from you as a journalist, considering how much you covered, to hear you say that. So when you're putting it together, maybe even in the moment, then overall, then are you more angry or are you sad at the state of where we're at?
I think sad is the best. There's the best word for America right now is sad. I mean, this has got to be the darkest chapter in American history. You can look back in history and go back and say, oh, well, the Civil War, okay, fine. But all I'm saying is this has to be the darkest chapter in American history. What I'm angry about, though, if I have to use the word angry, I'm angry about how social media has exploited this moment, and all big tech are like war profiteers that have exploited our divisions and keep feeding us these toxic feeds that make us more angry. You know, it's, oh, if you live in Manhattan and you're in a liberal bubble and you get this feed that just tells you what you want to hear and just makes you feel happy in your little bubble, and then you live in Texas, like I have a sister in Texas, right? She married a Republican, they all vote Trump, fine. But she gets a toxic feed that's all conservative, right? She gets a totally different feed on her phone. And then that makes for ugly family relations, right? So this is the year that 100%. Like friendships broke up, families started fighting, and that social media is exploiting the divide to make us hate each other in our own families and our own friendships. I feel like I'll reserve all of my anger for big tech and the way they've exploited this moment and haven't done anything to sort of help human relations. They've destroyed the social fabric of our democracy and our interpersonal relationships. And that is really criminal.
Well, I wanted to tell you, thank you for putting this out there. Please stay safe and healthy. You are a rock star. And I wanted to let you know that I've done my part. I voted.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, you're so sweet. You made my whole day. Thank you. Because, you know, there's this documentary, Filmmaking Life. I'm sitting on the floor in my apartment while I'm homeschooling two teenage boys in the back. You know, it's a very unglamorous life. So thank you for the love this morning, because it's really sort of making me feel a little bit better about myself. Because you know, when this movie comes out, it will just be like completely skewed. When you make documentaries and with my last name, you get more hate than you get love. There's not much love. So thank you for that little piece of sunshine that you've brought into my day.
Thank you.
The documentary is American Selfie. You can check it out now on Showtime. Until next time, I'm Rick Hong.